Hey, what's up, everybody? Today, we're going to learn all about filters in Adobe Photoshop. To get started, we're going to look at our filters panel. I have a few different images that will guide us through our filter journey, and we're going to start with the very first, which is this kind of town, small town neighborhood feel. I'm going to go up to filter, and you're going to be greeted with a ton of different filters that you could use. We have everything from neural filters to the old school filter gallery, to all sorts of fun things like 3D, where you can generate 3D maps like normal maps, blur gallery, distort, noise, pixelate, all sorts of fun stuff. Now, we're going to start with the one that you may use depending on the effect that you're making, but it's kind of more of a historical filter gallery. You may do this if you're trying to kind of posterize something, but I'm going to go to the filter gallery and we're going to start by opening that up right away. And this will open a whole new screen for you. And let's go ahead to the bottom here and I'll just fit this into my view in which you'll be greeted with your image and you can kind of add different patterns or different filters to your specific image. And the cool thing about this is you can actually layer these effects within the filter gallery. Now, some of these are really good if you're trying to do different types of textures or overlays or blending modes. Here's a great halftone one that you can kind of play around with to get kind of a fun, cool effect. You will use these from time to time. Overall, though, if you just click on the button, you'll notice they're not exactly, this doesn't exactly look painted. So these will take a little work and a little more blending with other layers to get it to work on the way that you like. If I go ahead and hit OK on this, I want you to notice as well is that it is a bit destructive. There are ways around that in which we can create something called a smart layer. So if I go ahead and kind of let's drag this image to the trash can. There we go. And I right click on that image, I can go ahead and create certain smart objects from this. So I'm going to right click and I'm going to navigate to smart object. There it is right there. And we're going to convert that. And now if we apply one of those fun filters, let's just keep the angled strokes one. This is actually going to give us a little second, but it will actually allow us to be a little more non-destructive. So I can go back and double click on this word filter gallery now. And it will open that back up. So that is a smart object in which we can create a smart filter, which also gives us a mask. The cool part about that is in the mask, if I don't want a part to be covered by the filter, I can just paint that respective part black, gray, or obviously white to reveal or conceal that mask. And so if I don't like this, I can drag them down to the trash can and I'm good to go. So those are your old school filters. The other filters you may use quite often are things like the blur filter. So we have different types of blur, like the famous Gaussian blur. Again, you can use smart objects to kind of have these be a little more non-destructive. One of my favorites is the new blur gallery. I guess it's not terribly new, but I do enjoy all of these. Tilt shift is a really fun one for an image like this. Tilt shift almost gives you like a toy-like appearance to your image, which is really, really fun. So I can kind of go and navigate, the distribution of my blur by moving these lines. I could rotate my blur to kind of match it up with this street. And as you can see, the cool part about this is it does give me this little bit of, isolation here. So if I go ahead and, for instance, we crank up that blur a little bit, we like what we see and we hit OK. Give that a second. It just kind of nicely blurs that out. And again, I have my smart blur here that I can go back and adjust because that's a smart object. The other one is field blur. Field blur is very confusing to people the first time they use it because it just blurs everything. What you do though is you add specific spots where your blur is going to be. So if I want to blur this area, great. If I add another area down here and I don't want to blur that area, I can go ahead and click in certain areas and take the blur away. Think of this more of like an isolation type blur, which is really cool. We have the iris blur. The iris blur is exactly that. It's just going to be a circle and it's going to kind of give you a bit of a radial blur, which you can play with Doesn't always work on an image like this, but we'll go ahead and give it a shot by stretching out the iris to a specific area. Again, iris blur. We have a path blur if we open up our path blur here, and these do take a few seconds to kind of load in. These will give you more kind of motion if you're trying to do kind of a quick motion pass or some sort of kind of special effect blur, you could totally do that. Same with the spin blur. It will exactly do that. It will give you a really fun kind of spin effect that you can kind of play with if you're trying to do some sort of visual distortion. The blur galleries are quite useful in your production to kind of isolate certain areas. Other things we can do with this, we could add a lens correction. So if you're taking a picture, and most lenses, as you all know, are curved, the lens correction tool will actually open it up and help you not curve that. So this will actually show the different types of cameras that this image was taken with. You can go in and play with the different lenses. It's really quite amazing that it will actually read the lens profile. The way I like to use this though, is I actually like to go and play a little bit in the custom tab, and I use this to create vignettes on my image. So if I wanna create a quick vignette, like a little dark edge vignette, I go to the custom tab and I do that, and then I just hit okay. Because I have this as that right click smart object, it's going to make it a little easier for me to navigate this. All right, so those are your main filters that you can kind of work with. We're gonna keep touching upon a couple of these as we go, but for instance, you can add noise to your image, again, as much or as little as you want. Let's go to the next image. In this next image, we have this nice kind of fruit basket. I wanna show you one of my favorite filters and techniques to use to sharpen an image in Adobe Photoshop. To do that, I'm gonna just duplicate my background layer, and I'm gonna call this layer high pass. And a high pass is essentially a sharpening layer. On that layer, I'm gonna go to filter, other, high pass. And that will give me a little drop-down box in which, if you look very closely, it's just taking the high contrast areas of that image and it's like amplifying them. When I do that, you look at this and go, eh, it doesn't look so great. But if I set this layer to an overlay and let's on and off it, if you look very closely, it sharpens the whole image. Where this image didn't look blurry before, when I have the high pass on, wow, it really, really, really makes a difference. So here's it with it on, here's it with it off. So quite a cool technique that you may use a lot with things like portraiture, you name it. So again, we can kill that layer by taking it down to the delete key. Now, other fun layers that you may play with in here, beyond the blurs and the high passes, you name it, are the neural filters. Now, neural filters are pretty new to Photoshop. These are, some of them are in beta, some of them are ready to go, but you have to download these separately. Think of them as kind of like plugins, if you're familiar with any software that uses plugins. But one of the ones that I like to use and that is pretty awesome is called the depth blur. And so the depth blur will allow you to do simulated depth of field on your imagery by just clicking on the image where you want it to focus. So if I want it to focus on this apple, it's going to actually blur everything outside of that apple. This used to actually be quite time consuming to do in general. So I can kind of play with that blur. As you can see, this was not blurry when we first started. So we can kind of play with that. We can output this as a depth map. A depth map essentially, if you're familiar with these, are how they're processing the blur. Everything in white in this case is super blurry. Everything in black is going to be sharp. And this can be used in all sorts of programs like 3D programs. This could be used in After Effects. It's actually a great way to kind of play around with that. And we can even output these as a new layer. And you can see the after, the before, the after, the before. And again, just a really fun way to kind of apply a quick filter. What we're gonna do with these, if you wanna go ahead and like zoom in with something, you could totally do that. And this is going to process this and actually help the artifacts of the actual image. Same with the kind of JPEG artifact removal or things like the photo restoration. Again, you have to download some of these, but if you wanna kind of fix an old damaged photo, this would be the tool to use. If you're not wanting to spend the time kind of focusing on things like the clone stamp tool and whatnot. It just depends on your situation. So all of these are really, really fun. And then the very last one, I have this really nice portrait here. I'm going to go to filter. And in our case, our model didn't seem terribly happy. Let's say you have that great photo shoot and you get a shot that's really well lit and you want to make a bit of adjustments. You have portrait options. So you could actually transfer makeup on an individual, which works not so well at this point. You can smooth the skin of an individual using this filter or use something like Smart Portrait, where you can actually change things like their expression, their eye direction, you name it. You know, these work pretty decently. Sometimes they have kind of silly results. But again, if you're looking for little tweaks, I wouldn't necessarily crank these kind of these sliders up a lot. This is definitely the place to go. So if we want to shift his eyes a little bit, we can do that. If that's not something we're looking for, again, we can kind of kill that, and then maybe we make them a little more happy using the happiness filter. Now that looks pretty good. We'll do a new layer and we'll hit OK. But now we have after, before, after, before. It's a pretty amazing image that you can work with. Now with this image, if you're not a fan of the neural filters, you could use something like the Liquify filter. The Liquify filter is absolutely really fun to use. The Liquify filter will actually select your character's face, which is really awesome, and allow you to play with things like eye size, tilt, nose, mouth. We can go ahead and still do the smile in this. So this is just another way to kind of tweak your character using the Liquify. Now, the Liquify filter is probably most famous for the different pucker, bloat, and kind of bend style tools. For instance, if I want to take a given area and move that, I can use any of these tools. I can warp them. You know, it kind of can make our character look pretty silly. I'm going to use the bracket keys just so you can see, and we can add maybe some, you know, height to his eyebrows. Just a little bump up here and there, which is really nice. Again, you can play with anything from maybe his forehead is too big. I think he's fine, but there we go. Maybe his chin needs to be a little longer. It's pretty scary how easy it is to play and adjust the different shapes of things as you go. And so as we create this, the great part about this stuff is, again, we can mask different areas. There's tons of different different options for you to kind of play with. But when we hit OK, you know, this is the neural filter. This is the very slightly touched up other image that we had using the Liquify tool. So those are just a few effects I want you to play around with. Go explore, have fun, use the images provided. I hope you enjoyed this lesson, and I will catch you next time.